As it stands, this file, so we have at the end, we have this integral, so action as phi, and then plus as psi, and action as usual is integral of the Lagrangian d tau 0 to d tau is equal to 1 over t. And in principle we see that we can, so we should try to integrate out phi. So now the question, we have two types of interactions actually. The interaction, this natural interaction which exists between paramagnets, and also the interaction which effectively exists between phi and psi. So in all this business, actually we neglect this interaction. There are reasons why one may do that. So without the interaction between electrons, we know that this is very important. This could drive the system at the transition, lead to some non-trivial scaling behavior, and so on. Now it is, we can neglect it. And what is important? I have not mentioned, we worked in two dimensions. In 2D. It's very important. So what our results are replicable, conclusions are replicable for two dimensions. 2D, so 2 plus 1, one time, and two space coordinates, which corresponds to this experimental situation. So then in principle, why can this be neglected? Suppose that we neglected the interaction between electrons and paramagnets and studied, suppose that we proceeded as people did previously, which means that we take in the main approximation renormalization of electron spectrum due to interaction with this critical mode. And it was known and for quite a long time that if one can make such a renormalization, this paramagnet one can somehow renormalize inserting this electron hole pairs, which is just some kind of screen. Then one comes to the following result, that instead of the previous D, one comes to such a spectrum which is this original omega squared, but plus some first linear part plus q minus q squared plus a. And this is the renormalization of this propagator. And this is actually, and this gamma is proportional to lambda squared. And this term I write here modulus because I use Matsubara frequencies. But this is nothing but so-called Landau damping. So, and this is what one takes into account. If one has this linear term here, we can already argue just by power counting that our theory becomes logarithmic. So I argued last lectures that if one wants to study the influence of this interaction term, this means that one should calculate this loop diagram, this pulse, and compare it with just interaction. And then if we have for this mode that spectrum with Landau depth, one gets the following, that one gets this propagator, we have d equals omega gamma plus u squared plus a. And if we have two such propagators, we get the integral 1 over gamma omega plus u squared plus a squared and d omega and d 2q. And so, r squared. What is this integral? So one doesn't need to think too long. It is just logarithmic of a. So the theory is logarithmic. If we include this Landau damping, then in two dimensions, this theory is logarithmic. And then one can write just renormalization groups, group equations, study RG flows. And effectively, this G effective at the renormalization goes to zero. This is like a conventional interacting system in four dimensions. You have classical system logarithms in four dimensions. And if you do RG, then the effective coupling constant logarithmically vanishes. Here it happens in two dimensions due to this frequency term.
Sorry, where we lose this quadratic term?
Quadratic term is simply not important. If you try to estimate this integral for a going to zero, then both omega and q, essential omega and q are very small, and actually going to zero if a goes to zero. Then omega squared is smaller than omega and can be less. This is just for estimate.
Okay, but does it depend on gamma? Because,
It depends on gamma, of course. It depends on gamma. So gamma, actually, if this delta, our parameter delta, if it is of the order of unity, gamma is actually also unity. If we have this delta, then we can play a little bit. But basically, gamma is somehow not far from unity.
So that means that in a realistic situation we could not neglect error.
We could write renormalization group, and then this renormalization group, the flows will go to zero. Of course, the starting point is already a little bit unclear, but the tendency to zero is universal. So therefore, in principle, the usual assumption in all this business is to neglect this term and consider the only interaction is phi with this psi, which we also follow. So we don't assume anything.
Can you say a few words about why is this some kind of damping? What physical sense it's a damping or
Landau damping?
Yes.
Landau damping. Which is in plasma, and somehow it is in plasma. You have damping of plasma waves.
But here it's for the spin waves. Or?
Here it is for spin waves. Yeah.
It's the particle will continue.
Actually, Landau damping originally it is for non-interacting electron gas.
So it gives some finite lifetime for the spin waves.
It is, if I wrote not in Matsubara but in real frequencies, yes, it would be ions, and this would be purely light diffusion. So it is typical form for diffusion. So more questions on that point. Okay, so what we do we neglect this term, and then this means that we can average in this integral, we can average immediately over phi, because it is quadratic. So I write it in more detail now. So this is the integral g phi d psi. So this means that we have this minus s psi, and we have also the integral here, integral psi, and then sigma phi. Here psi d tau d r, and we have to integrate over phi, and then we will integrate over psi. And the integral over phi can be done almost immediately. Okay, we have also, of course, this zero term. And zero term is okay. Sorry, is minus s phi. These two. And we have here quadratic form. And so here is not without interaction. And then we can integrate, and we get the effective Lagrangian. We have effective action of that type, d psi only. And this effective action can be written as follows.
Sorry.
Yep.
Did you use your model or to neglect? Did you use that you have a delta smaller than one?
Until now, no.
After now,
Until now, no. And then one gets the integral, one comes, the partition function is equal to s effective psi, d psi, and here s effective is equal to integral, and I write psi d tau plus epsilon gradient, and here psi. And then the term with psi, and here x, psi x, and here sigma, and then multiplied by psi x, x prime, sigma psi x prime x prime, and x contains both coordinate and time. And here some interaction lambda squared. So one gets effectively a system with interacting electrons, but interacting spins of electrons. And then what we want to do with this thing? It resembles very much what one does in the localization theory, and not only in localization theory. One has such an interaction. One makes first mean field theory, singling out proper pairing. First mean field. And second, fluctuations due to degeneracy of ground state.
Sorry, where did this go? The propagator or the...
Sorry. In between. The propagator is in between. So, the point is that we have now effective interaction with this propagator, and in principle, it should be inserted here, and this is the interaction, and we have we see that this interaction is somehow singular, because for A equals 0, when Q is close to Q large, and Tomido goes to 0, this interaction is picked. And here are this Q, and small one. And it contains sigma, and the only, and if you want to do the mean field, we can just use first diagrammatic expansion, and we want to understand what pairing is most important. And already we have seen these ladders. This is a copper ladder. This is a superconducting ladder. This is particle hole ladder. And we can try first mean field, just singling out the suspicious pairings. And these suspicious pairings, and this psi, contains the original fermionic fields phi as chairs. This is already written in some kind of form having both holes and high and high complex conjugates, such that I use doublets, and already in terms of this psi, one has as you can see it. So psi is somehow a two-component vector. So I have jumped, I believe, and therefore I would like to understand, is that clear what I have said or not? So if one considers superconductivity, one uses this Bogoliubov-like transformation. One introduces some operators containing creation and annihilation operators, and writes already in terms of those. So here I also write in terms of those. But due to this SU2 symmetry of the model, the solution will be not just superconducting of the parameter, but it will contain mixture of both superconducting and particle hole. That's the idea. But in principle, this is the standard possibility to write everything in terms of such vectors of two fermionic, so fermionic field high and high complex conjugate. Or you expect more details to be displayed, or it is completely clear? Not clear. So, suppose I have from the beginning, I explain how it comes. And this is done just in order to, if I used what letters I used for the fields. That's the problem. I used also psi. Let me do the following. I want to write the following thing. I want to introduce psi capital, which is this psi complex conjugate and psi. All right. Then I write some kind of psi conjugate some which is analogous to charge conjugation which is used in quantum field theories. And this one will be minus psi and here psi conjugate. So, and I write here square root. Then the scalar product psi psi is equal anyway psi psi. Right? Because I multiply this with this and they anti-commute, and then I multiply this with this. So I get the same. Okay? And the same with the Hamiltonian that we had. Psi and here d, d tau plus and here plus epsilon minus I gradient. Actually, it is okay. One can do it this way, and okay, I will write it in a little bit different form. Right here. Okay, I don't want to go into details, but anyway, it can be also written in terms of psi, and here I have minus d, d tau. Plus. And if I write here the linear terms, then it will be v grad and here psi large. And there is matrix tau 3 here. And tau 3 is equal to 1. So here I have written just linearized the spectrum because epsilon of p is equal to p squared minus mu and is approximately v p minus p. So therefore, what I do, I just form these doublets. And this is just conventional thing in the theory of superconductivity. So this is just Bogolyubov transformation, nothing more.
I guess that you have some integration by parts.
Yes. Yeah. So in the principle, what is also important that I have psi and sigma, and here psi is equal to again, and here I write psi large and sigma and again tau 3 and psi. So all terms somehow require tau 3 or 1. May meet this tau 3 absorbing it into the definition of psi conjugate, but anyway, everything at the end is invariant under rotations and in this space, so 2-on-2 space, that's the point. And this is just this symmetry, this SU2 symmetry of that original model, and this SU2 symmetry is valid if we write the spectrum here linearizing it. If we use the linearized spectrum, which means that we neglect the curvature. If we include the curvature, then this symmetry of SU2 symmetry is somewhat violated, superconductivity should win. But if curvature is small, then this SU2 symmetry is approximate. And moreover, we will see that fluctuations using some sigma model and renormalization group, that fluctuations will drive the system to isotropic, to complete SU2 symmetry, which is also non-trivial fact, but which is very crucial for our explanation what this pseudo-gap state is. So until now I have not done much. I just introduced these doublets, nothing more. And have told that using this psi capital, these doublets, one can see this SU2 invariance of the system. This is like in quantum electrodynamics, one has particles, one has electrons and positrons, and one has some symmetry between them. So this is unification in a doublet, both types of excitations. So, are there questions on that?
This symmetry was from the very beginning Lagrangian.
This symmetry more or less the following, that here we understand that what is important is the vicinity of hot spots.
Yes.
This symmetry is the consequence that our interaction is important only for scattering of electrons from the vicinity of a hotspot to the from vicinity of hotspot to vicinity of the other hotspot, only from narrow region. But in this narrow region, the spectrum, this Fermi surface is almost linear. So this is linearization. That we have not this curvature, but we can approximate in the small vicinity, we can approximate by straight line. And this SU2 symmetry is valid just because you can approximate it by a straight line. So it is, in the beginning we didn't, so there is nothing special, no SU2 symmetry here for this model.
So in that model it is absent unless you linearize epsilon?
Yes.
Okay.
So it appears as the result of linearization. This linearization is possible because this interaction is singular and it scatters not from here to somewhere here, such that really the curvature will be felt, but it scatters from this vicinity to small vicinity here. And therefore, as the zero approximation, we say that this is linear. And then it is SU2 symmetry. But it exists. It is still violated. Curvature exists. But then we will show that this small curvature, that this will driven by the normalization group, it will be driven to zero. So therefore, for high temperatures, when fluctuations become stronger and stronger, we will have a complete symmetry between particle hole and superconducting state. And this is our interpretation of what this pseudo-gap state is. It is just that mixture, isotropic mixture of particle holes, so it is just some kind of fluctuating quartet of two particles and two holes.
Sorry,
so
just a very naive question. If I just take the bare kinetic energy for the fermions, is this term symmetric under this SU2?
No, if it is exact, it is not.
Okay.
It is symmetric only if you linearize.
Okay, so that's part of
the answer to Ricardo. Yes. This is SU2, it is not exact SU2 present in the original mode.
Okay. Just the kinetic.
Therefore, it has been noticed by these people, Subirsaj and Mitlitsky, only in 2010, after 10 years of study this model. So this symmetry was overlooked, but again, this is an approximate symmetry, it is not exact symmetry. The point that it can be the symmetry still show up and be restored by fluctuations. That's already our observation. So therefore, nothing unrealistic in the original model except this small delta, but otherwise nothing wrong. So is that point clear? Okay, now what I will do, so what we did is just the standard mean field theory. So we cannot solve so we go to the part, to the step one. Of course, as soon as we have this interaction, and as soon as we are not in the one dimension, we cannot solve anything exactly. And therefore, we try some approximations, and we will justify these approximations using some small parameter, and again, this artificial small delta is sufficient to justify the approximations. Our approximation is the following. We have, so mean field. We have psi, I write it this way, psi x, and here sigma psi x, and here psi x prime, sigma psi x prime, and this diffusion, this perpendicular. And then, instead of studying this thing exactly, we replace it by average, and average is somehow of that time. So we replace this product of two psi bar, we replace it by some matrix psi, and I write here x, u, x, x prime, and here I write psi x prime, and here dx, dx prime, and here also dx, dx prime. So, product of these three is replaced by matrix. Just conventional trick of the mean field. And then one tries to find this parameter q using some self-consistency equation. This means that one has now effective Lagrangian and effective, okay, this is mean field, and mean field Lagrangian is equal now to psi, and here d tau, and here minus v grad, and here plus actually q psi x. And then one wants to find self-consistently this q, and one writes such an equation x, x prime, and psi prime, and here average with this mean field Lagrangian. So this mean field Lagrangian, this one. One writes this mean field Lagrangian with Q, and then finds this Q self-consistently from this equation. This is just standard mean field. If you study, for example, Heisenberg or Ising model in the mean field approximation, this is more or less the same. If one uses BCS theory of superconductivity, it is just the same. Although the structure of this psi is different. So what new has happened with respect to conventional theory of BCS superconductivity? This is already 2-on-2 matrix. Okay, plus spin, then it is even larger size. But actually, the self-consistency equation is satisfied for singlet pairing, so that's, I don't mention anymore spin. Spin is not important. But one solves this equation.
Sorry, so what happened to d of x minus x prime?
D, it should be here, of course. Thank you. It should be d of x minus x prime. So in principle, two sigma center here. Of course, I can write here a sigma vector and here a sigma vector. These are details, but somehow. Now I hope that I didn't forget anymore anything. So, and this is equation. What is important is this Q in principle depends due to this singular character of this D, because it is not just delta function x minus x prime. This Q depends on frequencies. This equation can be solved explicitly only numerically. But it can be brought first to a very nice dimensionless form, and then already solved numerically for the value of this U. What is important of the value of Q? So that Q has the following form. It is something like I, and here minus U, here U, plus zero. This is some space, so lambda space, and this lambda space is pairing between, so we can write it as matrix, but it is not important. What is important then, U is arbitrary. So U plus dagger is equal to unity, unitary matrix, and U is SU belongs to SU2 group. So the solution of this self-consistency equation is degenerate. So what does it mean? So if we had only superconductivity, the solution for superconductivity is degenerate because the phase, superconducting phase, is arbitrary. Then one would have for superconductivity a U2 symmetry. Here we have degeneracy also between superconductivity and particle hole. And this is SU2 symmetry, degenerate. And some constant, and here some constant, and this is a function of epsilon. I will show explicit equations.
I'm sorry, what about the flavors? I'm confused.
Flavor?
Yeah, and
I don't use flavor as a large n limit, so anyway doesn't help, as it was shown. Then we just use this n equals 1, although we can put any n.
So that matrix Q is for n equal 1.
Yes. We could write, and we wrote actually for any n, simply it is not realistic to have large n first, and second it doesn't help. Therefore the only thing that helps us to do this analysis is this small angle delta. Large n flavor is not necessary. But the point is that the ground state of the system in this mean field approximation has SU2 degeneracy. It is not only phase-like in superconductivity, but it is also just the global invariance under rotations between superconductivity and particle hole. So, therefore, it was completely new step, because people, when speaking of this critical behavior, usually until our work, so people simply wrote exponents, some scaling behaviors, and never anything more. So So we do completely different scheme. But we first solve this mean field, and then on top of that we will study fluctuations of this mean field. And it will be shown that everything is justified for small delta, so first mean field, and second, fluctuations. And fluctuations are non-trivial because we have the degeneracy of the ground state. And fluctuations related to this massive, so this produces Goldstone modes. So this ground state, this symmetry is broken, and then it leads to Goldstone modes, and these Goldstone modes are massless in two dimensions and lead to some logarithmic contributions. One should write renormalization group equations and then to see where the system is driven to. So, therefore, fluctuations are for the next lecture, and now I show the formal result for the mean field. So, these are equations. So, the mean field, we did the following. That first, we, in the mean field, on the diagrammatic language, it means that we have some all types of non-crossing diagrams. And also, we renormalized this effective interaction. D inserting here these loops. So that's our scheme. We do self-consistently, putting everywhere these non-intersecting diagrams, and here putting this particle hole. And beautifully at the transition point, everything is dimensionless. We don't have any parameters, and equations are dimensionless. And therefore, can be it is quite good for numerical study because we just have the solution which is unique. Then we have this parameter gamma, it is energy scale. And these gaps that we obtained, this order parameter, it is of the order of lambda squared, the original interaction at the transition. So, which means if we solve this equations which give us just numbers, just some functions, dimensionless functions, we will get energy scales of the order of gamma. So, our order parameter will be proportional to lambda squared. And not exponentially small as in Barden, conventional Barden-Cooper-Schiffer superconductivity. So, which allows us to say that even if the interaction is weak, it will lead to some order parameter which is not exponentially weak. It is weak only as this lambda squared. Therefore, we can immediately say that to get 100 Kelvin as transition temperature or higher, several hundreds, so it's quite natural in this system even for weak interaction. So therefore, just about large values of transition, and moreover, this transition into pseudo-gap state, it is something like up to 300 Kelvin, so it is very high values. Therefore, these high values are very natural if we speak in terms of this critical model. And these are the solutions. So this is the value of the gap in this dimensionless unity. So we have the only scale, this gamma, which is proportional to lambda squared, and it is proportional also to delta, this small delta. So we scale frequencies, Matsubara frequencies in this gamma, we scale the value of the gap in this gamma, and we scale temperature in terms of gamma. And then we have to solve numerically these equations. Everything is unambiguous. This is the solution of this order parameter as a function of frequency. This is also a new feature that the order parameter depends also on frequencies. So in BCS theory, the order parameter is just constant in frequency. Here it is a function. This is due to a very single character of this function delta. And then it is just function of frequency, and it is function of temperature, it is finite. And also, of course, we have checked the free energy. This is minus free energy. It is always positive, which means that below critical temperature, there is some critical temperature. So this is critical temperature. But below the critical temperature, this will be just finite wave. And always the free energy is negative, which means that we really get some minimum, this complex state, which is more favorable than the normal metal. And it is at the critical point. And of course, the crucial question is that what is about fluctuations? Fluctuations on top of this mean field. So whether they are important or not. And the answer is they are important, but not in the way how important fluctuations are in the conventional picture of quantum phase transition. They are important in such a way that I will anticipate the result. And the same that they are important in the way that really fluctuations drive the system to the limit of strong fluctuations, and there is complete isotropy between superconductivity and this particle Hall state. And we identify it with this pseudo-gap state. So there is no long-range ordered pseudo-gap state. There is complete mixture of these two, superconductivity and insulator. And only at smaller temperature, when the fluctuations become smaller, the effects of curvature are more important, and the system simply flips into the superconducting state. But this superconducting state is very close to this particle Hall state. And applying a magnetic field, one can rather easily go from superconducting state to the particle Hall. That's what experiments, many different types of experiments show nowadays. Just development of last 2 years, I must say, we were extremely lucky proposing this theory in time. Neither 1 year before nor 1 year later would count. But the point is that really this superconductivity competes with some kind of what we call a quadrupole density wave. So therefore, this scenario is completely different from conventional theory of quantum critical phenomena. We don't know what happens just here, still has to be studied, but there are already some preliminary understanding of what is going here and how it can explain some recent experiments. Okay, I guess that's enough for today. I'm glad we will either be more fast in showing the results.
I'm not sure I understood. So if I just stay at the mean field level, you have a transition between what and what in terms of phases.
So just mean
you
field.
You're varying lambda, for instance.
So on mean field level, we get some order. And this order is arbitrary order, either superconductivity or this quadrupole density wave or their mixture. But below the transition point, one has a normal metal.
And what are the spins doing in that phase?
Nothing. Everything is singlet. Just singlet. So this pairing is completely singlet, so no spin structure. So spins happen together. The spins of particle, two particles and particle holes are opposite. So it's spins of this cluster of tetra.
In the original spin fermion model, if the fermions build a conventional metal, then...
Then they have spins, of course, they have spins, but after you get your on the mean field level, after you get this condensate of these two particles and two holes, so the spins are bound. So these four, two particles and two holes, they have somehow opposite spins. So this is electron, two electrons, it opposite spins somehow, and two holes, and they have also opposite spins. So therefore, the entire speed of the spin of these four particles is zero. In that sense, that there is no spin. But this transition on the mean field theory, field level, it is this transition. You see that still, we on the mean field level, we get this transition at T, which is, we identify it with this T star, which is seen experimentally. But then we say that nevertheless, fluctuations are very important. And therefore, if we go below this transition temperature, fluctuations are so strong that you don't have any long-range order. And only at considerably low temperatures, the system chooses, fluctuations are already small, and the system chooses where it wants to be, in superconductor or in this insulator. Normally it chooses to be in superconductor, if you don't apply a magnetic field. Then you are here in the superconductor. If you apply a magnetic field, it can become an insulator. It is seen experimentally. The fields are not so large.
So with their V value, could you actually trace this border between green and pseudo gap?
Green and pseudo gap. So you have this matrix U, which is unit.
Yeah.
So this matrix has the following form: plus complex conjugate minus complex conjugate. These are superconducting deltas. These are this particle hole. Mm-hmm. So when we are in the pseudo gap state, all of them are mixed and fluctuate so homogeneously. So that really it is a mixture. You cannot prefer one to the other. In the green region below that, this delta plus turns to zero, delta minus becomes a constant. This is superconducting. So this picture, so somehow can be. Where was this picture? So if you have one axis superconductivity and the other axis this quadrupole density wave. So if you are in the superconducting state, this other parameter can be represented also by vector, by a four-component vector. So this matrix corresponds to this theta, corresponds to vectors on circle. Then you have superconductivity just theta equals zero. So you have only superconductivity. Quadrupole density wave, you have theta equals pi half. This is one and this is zero. And pseudo gap state when this vector fluctuates homogeneously between two axes. This is due to fluctuations. And this is the result of renormalization group study of the sigma model. So the normalization group equations drive the system to such a mixed state. Anisotropy between superconductivity and this quadrupole density wave is lost due to fluctuation. And these fluctuations are studied by the sigma model, and one can write the corresponding RG equations, and one can see that system is driven to disordered state, so no long range order, but at the same time, the anisotropy between superconductivity and particle hole state is lost. So these two effects happen at the transition. So this is what happens at the transition, that somehow this complete anisotropy between two states and absence of long range order. Here you get long range order, and the anisotropy, isoisotropy is violated.